It's 2015, and I got a deadline. I got to get this tiny little utility server built by Friday. And I'm sweating bullets. And I go to the local coffee shop, and I sit down, and I'm trying to figure out, why am I writing the same code for the 15,000th time? How many of these Hello World ping servers did we really need? My fortunes just got better. Someone left the USB key. I walked over to my computer. I was like, I wonder what's on it. And so, like all good engineers, you put it right in your production corporate computer. And just my luck, there's a folder. And it's called free software. The world is so kind. So I click on it, and wow, this looks like the code I need to write. I mean, there's a README and everything. There's only one safe option here, which is to install it on your computer. Now, I don't know about you, I'm pretty skeptical finding random code and thinking it's going to work. So the next thing you do is you run some executable commands like the build process. Oh, it looks like it works. Okay, so the next thing to do is, you know, I trust this. I mean, good Samaritan left their USB key around, and I'm gonna push it to production, right? Like, no harm, no foul. And look, I'm container native these days, or cloud native these days, so I mean, I have a Docker file and everything. Now, I'm noticing a little thing here. It's not red, right? Like normally when you're driving, the traffic light is yellow, that means slow down, but it doesn't mean stop. So I'm just going to use my judgment, because if they wanted me to stop, it would have obviously been red. So we're gonna keep going. We're using the cloud, and the cloud is secure by default, isn't it? So I deploy it there, and who needs access control? You click on the URL, and oh, it's a ping server, so if I just hit ping endpoint, it totally works. Legit. I just saved the day. There's this saying, great developers copy, good developers paste. And that's what I did. So I'm back to work, and I walk in, and life is good. Now, my boss, he's typically a cool guy, but he was pretty pissed off. I mean, I'm like, what's the problem, man? Now he's red. And it turns out those warnings, if you dig into it, those warnings were actually pretty serious. There's a bunch of stuff in there that need to be fixed. Now, my app is written in Go. I'm not sure what Python is doing, but look, it's there. And it's red. I didn't put it there, so I don't understand what the problem is. Now, here's the problem. The worst thing about this whole thing was my whole team found out. And we're like, what the hell is going on here? And we devised a plan. I don't know about you, but if you ever have that boss that like kind of stalks you to make sure that you learn new skills and get things fixed, well, that was happening to me. And we came up with this plan. Whenever he would show up, we would just pretend like we're working on something super critical and just be distracted, and he would probably leave us alone. And the weird thing is, like everywhere I went, like to the micro kitchen, to the bathroom, there he was. Just standing there, awkward as hell. And I'm sitting at my desk. I was like, man, I don't want to look. I bet he's behind me. I don't want to look, though. And I said, oh, the plan. So he's on the way. And you know, if you're like me, when you're working on something serious, you got to put your headphones in. So I throw my headphones in to see if he would leave me alone. It totally works. For some reason, he don't like that song. So we're going to talk about the secure supply chain. And so when we think about this problem, and you ask yourself, like, hey, my little trick only buys me so much time. We need a long-lasting plan. That's not going to work forever. You can't just ignore these things. You actually need to tackle them. And this gets really boring over time. And so, look, I went around. If you Google for all the latest and greatest technology, you end up finding something in the CNCF. They have all the software now, right? This is the landscape. It's like, whatever you're trying to do, cure cancer, it's a tile on here somewhere, guaranteed. You just got to find it. And so what I really wanted was to learn the fundamentals. I don't want to just download a piece of software because I got in trouble doing that last time. I want to learn how it actually works. And so I found this SALSA framework. And the interesting thing about the secure supply chain, it really begins earlier than you think. A lot of people are thinking about vulnerabilities and scanning software. We've been doing that for decades now, and I don't think it's gotten us any better position than we were before. So you scroll to the side, and what is it? It's a framework, and they do a decent job explaining the problem. So the beginning of the software supply chain is you, right? The people who write code and develop software. And then along that chain, even before we get to deployments, even before we get to the server, there's all of these attack vectors. Now, most of us have been taking software for granted for a long time, right? Think about it. We take a lot of things for granted in our lives because they just work, right? Just most of the time they work. You get in your car, you drive, it just works. You turn the key, it just works. You stop, you check the mail, you take the mail out, you put it on the front seat, and you drive. But this day, you're a little late. So you're speeding down the highway, and you jam on your brakes. But the person behind you isn't so reactive as you are. And they push you into the other car. And the airbag goes off. Now, your face is ruined, but you have your life. Now you're at home for a while, and you look over on the nightstand, and you see that stack of mail that you ignored for a few weeks. And the first letter at the top, you open it, and it's the dealership telling you there's a recall on your airbags. You got lucky this time. That could have easily not deployed. See, there was a known problem with that airbag. And you ask yourself, how were they able to notify me? How do they know that I have a faulty airbag? Well, the truth is, if there's enough incidents, they can aggregate that data across all the manufacturers, and they have things like VIN numbers. And they can tie back all the faulty parts, and if there's any matches, they can send out notifications. We don't have that in software today. A lot of you are like, he is crazy. He's picking up a random USB key, sticking it in his laptop, and sending it to production. Y'all act like y'all don't got GitHub accounts. Y'all are literally doing this every day. And it's actually becoming a serious problem. The more software gets put into more critical places, this is unacceptable. And so who is it on to fix? And so you can see at the beginning of the software supply chain, it's us, we're the developers. We're responsible for deciding what goes into the source code. Right? If you're gonna bake a cake, you need to know if you're putting something in there that could harm people. That's on you, not the people that are eating. They're not your QA team. Hey, I'm dead. The cake's no good. You don't get to make a new version of the cake. It's too late. So we have to change the way we think about this. You continue to scroll down. They talk about a bunch of things. And the thing I thought was super helpful were the various levels. And when it comes to security, most people try to go all or nothing. And this is the huge mistake in software today, right? Security is a practice. You'll never be 100% secure, but we can at least make steps towards it and chip away. The more you learn, the more you put in place. And so we're gonna go back to that little example that I had, that little simple ping server. I have it online now. And this ping server It's super simple. And you're like, damn it, where's the README? Who launches projects without READMEs? So the first thing we want to do is probably get some documentation in place. And so we're going to start there. So I'm going to copy over some docs. So here's my source code. I'm just going to copy over this little README that I have so we understand what the thing does. So the first step is, I think, is to understand your software to some degree. How many people do stuff like this? Git add dots. Like, what are you doing? Like, everything that's available. Git commit, and then it's like changes. looks good to me. Okay. What, we don't have this? Oh, did I not have? Wi-Fi is down. They told me it was good. All right, I think we just renewed our minutes. We can push software now? We are back in business? Oh, you want to jump in the talk too? You know Golang? All right, ooh, echoes, gone. That's a player move. You just walk up and click one button and you're gotta learn that one. All right, so we have a ping server. There's documentation. I actually think this is the first step in a secure supply chain. It's not written in there, but most people have no idea how their software works or how it's supposed to work. And so we start with this README. And so it's a simple server. You saw it, we run it, you call ping, it replies Pong. And so we go through this and we look at the requirements. So there's security levels. Our goal in this talk is to make it as far to level 4 if we can, and we gotta look at the requirements. So we look at the security levels, and security level 1, documentation of the build process. What the hell? That's it? I mean, that's like a trophy for everybody in here, I hope. And so I was like, it can't be that easy. So I dig into the requirements a little more, and it says it's a scripted build. Scripted build? I can do that. I know Bash. I can literally write Bash for this one. So you go over and you get the trusty Bash script. That's my build script. I write Golang, real simple. Right, I just want to build everything. And one thing I like to do that sometimes is controversial is I like to vendor my dependencies. And people are like, Kelsey, you're a madman. Why would you vendor your dependencies? You can just pull them from the super secure safe internet when you need them. And I'm like, aren't you the same person on Twitter complaining about not being able to do builds when GitHub is down? True. Submit your damn dependencies. You should be able to actually do a build regardless of what's going on with the network. And depending on the language you're using, those version numbers are a little squishy. You can replace 001 with another 001. So we need to probably vendor this stuff to make sure we have what we need. Now, the other thing that I think is also a good idea is to have a software bill of materials. Now, this gets a little squishy because there's a lot of detail in these things, and they're called SBOMs. And think about them like that food label, right? If you're allergic to peanuts, you want to make sure the thing you're about to eat doesn't contain peanuts. And so the idea here is that not all languages are created the same. And so in some cases, we just want another process that takes all of our dependencies and tells us what they are. And again, Go supports this natively. Different languages do it in different ways. This little simple ping server, I guess somebody really wanted Prometheus sort support. So these two lines turn into like all of these dependencies, right? Like you basically need the whole internet if you want to use Prometheus. But it's fine, software is safe. All right, so the next thing we do is we have the build script, right? So now we have this thing scripted out, and so we're ready for level 1. I just want to make sure my build script actually works, right? Very simple. And I'm just going to call it /bin build, and it downloads the internet. All that's safe though, so don't worry about it. Nothing turned red. Red is bad, everything else is legit. So we have a build script. So the next thing we're going to do is celebrate our victories. This is the thing people don't do. If you make a small improvement to your security posture, you should celebrate that. And one thing that I like that they've done with this project is they have added badges, right? Badges are cool. You can show your friends. I show my wife my GitHub badges. She's like, I literally don't care. But I do. All right, so we do git status. I can type. All right, so we're going to we're gonna add the README this time and git commit. We need a strong commit message this time. So I think we do more changes. Git push origin main. And then what do we get? Now that we've checked that box off, we go back to our repository and we hit refresh. And we can signal to the world, we salsa level one. Now don't go get no tattoos that say salsa because we could change the name. It's not what we're doing. We're just communicating that as we learn, we're making improvements to our software. Now there's another thing that you need to actually get to salsa level one that I skipped over, which is this thing called province. And province is tricky because a lot of people think as long as there's no vulnerabilities, we're good. As long as we have an automated build process, we're good. But some of the major exploits lately have been inside of the build system. That's a blind spot. And so there's a proposal, and look, I think this is where things get overly complicated, because what they're doing is asking people to generate a bunch of metadata, and I honestly think it's really hard to generate this metadata. It looks a little like this. And you can tell it's designed for computers and not humans, but I'm gonna try to walk you through it. My build script's goal is to produce multiple binaries for the thing I'm building. So those are going to be the subject of this attestation that I'm about to make, okay? And so one binary is a ping server for my Mac, ARM64, and there's a digest, okay? And this digest is the hash of that binary. Now, some people are going to very extreme measures by building things in two different build systems with two different teams and making sure they get the same hash back. So you need reproducible builds for that. That's not a day one thing, but it's a North Star. And I'm gonna do the same thing for my Linux AMD64, and there's another hash. And then here's where things get interesting. You have this province, and then we wanna know who's building this. This could be your build system. In this case, I'm doing this as myself. Maybe I can use my credentials in the automated build system, or I can do it on my laptop. You can have different build types. I actually made my own for this talk so I can understand the spec, and I just made one based on Go. So I created a new build type. Invocation, now this is where you start to get a little bit more information about the build context itself. What source repository are you building? What's the commit hash of that source repository? So we're starting to capture the inputs that go into those outputs. And then we have a build config. And again, I just made this up for my new build type. And what I'm doing here is mimicking what the Go build tool already does. But I want to do it in a way where I can generate this additional metadata and then sign it and make it available so people know that not only am I keeping track of my dependencies, I'm also keeping track of the context in which I build. And down here, you can see that there's some targets that I want, those two things that we saw at the top. We see that there's some flags. I'm actually going to build my binaries with the version control info built in. And then I'm going to record things like when did I start the build and when did I end. Now, one thing I think the Go team has done really good, and all programming languages have different degrees of support for stuff like this, when you build a Go binary, you actually have access to a lot of the build info built into the binary. And I hope other languages do this at some point. So if I do, I'm gonna look at one of those artifacts. And if I do build info, oh my God, where is it at? Oh, gotta spell it right. Oh, there we go. All right, so we're gonna give it a binary. And what you get in the Go language ecosystem is you get binaries that carry around a lot of this metadata. If you look in there, you can see the Go version. Let me make this a little bigger. You can see the Go version. You can see things like build flags. You can actually see more granular dependencies. And so carrying this around in the binary, I think it's going to let us build more tools a bit better that actually get somewhere. Now, I've been thinking about this. Dependencies are kind of the biggest problems we have, right? And people write software these days, and there's so many dependencies. And I'm like, damn, there's got to be a better way. I wish I could just write a very secure programming framework myself to cut back on this. And so I was super frustrated going through all of this work. I sat down at an airport, and I wrote this new project, and it's called No Code. And I was like, there has to be a way. I just want something that lets me write. And you can see it in the about. The best way to write secure and reliable applications, write nothing, deploy nowhere. Now, it took me a long time to produce this framework, so I wanted to document it so people know how to use this thing. And so our goal is, I like to do tutorials. That's just my thing. So getting started, you start by like literally writing no code, okay? So what your IDE should look like is that. If you see anything other than that, it's a syntax error. Full stop. Now, here's the thing. That's just an example, right? Like Kelsey, that's hello world, anyone can do that. But imagine if you wanted to do something else, like you want to add some new feature. That's a little easy too, but it's a little more complicated. A little more complicated. It's going to look a little like this. And the possibilities are endless, but you have to build the application. My build system is super slick. It's the best build system ever. You run that command, whole app is ready to go. That's it. And you're going to get output that looks like this. Again, if you see anything else, there's a problem. You can imagine how to deploy it. You can do that. You can scale. I know, right? All right, here's the contribution guide. I know all you're like, hey, Kelsey, you probably have ideas on how to make this better. So if you want to contribute, you don't. But that's not enough for most people. Most people will never make it to the bottom of the README. So I do have a contribution guide. And it's really clear, like all changes are welcome as long as it contains no code or no code is involved. If you run into any bugs, please file an issue and explain how the hell that was even possible. And I have a lot of stars on this. I literally thought about quitting my job and raising an A round on no code. The weirdest thing is there's like 4,000 issues. And the funny thing is the community is jumping in, helping each other. I actually had someone's manager DM me on Twitter. It's like, Kelsey, you have to take the repository down. I'm like, for what? It's like, people are in Slack wasting time. Oh, no, Caripo. Like, not my problem, man. And so I think that is a solution. But we have to get back to reality. And so our next thing is to get to the next level. So look, we're at salsa level one. And our goal is to get to the point where we go to salsa level three. Now, there's a bit more work that has to be done. And I'll be honest with you, going through this, I'm getting the feeling that this stuff is getting so complicated that most developers are not wanting to deal with this. I get that the problem is serious, but truthfully, right now, the tools just are not easy to use. Look at all these manifests. Who's going to read them? No one's going to go line by line. These things are being written for computers. And so for people working in this space, I think the feedback you have to take is that if this isn't going to be human-centric, then humans are not going to use it, right? The computers are not going to secure all of this stuff, so I think we're going to have to also figure out UX. Now, to get to salsa level three, one of the requirements is version control. It's 2022. If you ain't got version control right now, that's a problem. But luckily for us, we're using version control. I do have this thing checked in with the README and everything, so we're on our way to version 3, not that hard. Verified history. Now, what's this one all about? If you click in there, there's details, is that every change should have at least one strongly authenticated actor, right? You guys know how these code reviews goes, right? The bigger the code review, the faster it looks good to me. I ain't looking at all that. 3 lines of code, you're there for an hour. Like, yeah, I don't know if that matches the style guide. When it's 10,000 lines of code, you're like, dude, I think this looks good to me. You can ride with it. But we at least want anyone doing that to have signed commits. Now, to my surprise, not a lot of people are doing this. A lot of people don't know you can even do this. What does it look like? Like when you hit on your commits, this little verify thing is serious. Most people don't even know it's a thing. Like you can click on it and you can see that I have a verify signature. You can turn this on GitHub. I can see the faces in the room like, ooh, what's that? And so without this, that means if I knew your email address, I can just start committing code to other repositories. And as long as you have not enabled the verification, I can be you. And you have to sign your commits. And people are like, Kelsey, I don't GPG, I'm allergic, I can't use it on my computer. It's like, there are enough tools these days to manage your keys for you. If you're using Mac, you can even integrate with the keychain and encrypt it and all of that. And so then people say, Kelsey, well, what's the next step? Like, once I have that, what do I do after that? Well, you need to update your Git config. And it's like, oh, this is gonna be crazy. It's actually fairly straightforward in my book. You put this line in your Git commit, your Git config, and it will sign your commits for you. So after today, no one in this room should not be pushing up things without signed commits. You gotta do that part. That's the beginning of that chain. And so once we have signed commits in place, we are now on our way to level 3. I'm really looking forward to this badge. My performance review is coming up, and if I can just get this repo to Salsa 3, it's on. Retain the repository indefinitely. I'm one of those Git push force people, and so I'm gonna have to change my behavior. She was shaking her head like, me too. I don't like those commits. So you're gonna have to keep this stuff around because we need to know how things have evolved over time. And so you're gonna make some commitments, and this is gonna be a people thing, that you really need to adhere to some type of SLA around how long you're gonna keep things. Right now the guidance is 18 months, and if you wanna get to the highest Salsa rating, you're gonna have to keep it around forever. And so the next thing is, we need to use a build service, build this code, ephemeral build environments, isolated. It's like, oh my God, what the hell is this? And most people run their own build server, rightfully so. You have hardware on-prem, maybe even the cloud, and just think about it for a moment. That build server runs and builds your Node.js application, and you don't want to tear it down because it's too slow, so you keep it there, you keep it warm. If anything has poisoned that VM, it will be warm for all your other code. And people are just reusing these servers without thinking about, has any other software left something behind? And so now you think about these hosted services like GitHub Actions, there's lots of them. They tend to reset the build environment on every build, clean things out, make sure that you're starting from a clean slate. And so the recommendation here is just to use a build service. And I think this one's also pretty easy to do because most of these new build services are actually doing something like this. So we might be able to check that off. And what that looks like if you're using something like GitHub Actions, by the way, is a lot of them will have like these declarative configs. For example, you can just define your build steps. This one just checks out the code, but you can add additional steps that build your application, check for vulnerabilities, run a linter, that kind of thing. But then if you do this, you should be adhering closer to the thing. All right, so the next thing we need to do, and as we get closer to the end here, is we need to think about this province thing. Right now, I'm generating this metadata that I'm doing this in the build server, but you have no idea that I just make that up on my laptop or did the build system actually do it. And so this is where it's gonna be really important to use things like keys. I think GPG is gonna be enough for most use cases. There's projects like Cosign that you can look into, but now there are much better ways of signing these things. So I'm gonna show you what this looks like. I'm gonna try to tie everything together in order to try to get to this Salsa level 3. And so one thing I noticed that I actually tried to find something that works. I mean, I've looked at a lot of open source projects to create these builds for me, and there was more code than the code that I was testing or asserting. So I did what every smart engineer does. I built my own tool to do this stuff. And actually, it wasn't that hard. I dove into the spec to figure out everything that I needed. And that tool was really simple that I ended up with. And I'm going to show it to you a little bit now. So my goal is to generate all my artifacts, but this time, I want them signed. I want the SBOM manifest. I want the build providence. And I want all those things signed, too. And what I'm going to do here is mimic what you would do in a CI/CD system. So you could imagine the starting point. Most of these things all work the same. If you're Jenkins, GitHub Actions, it just doesn't matter. It's roughly the same amount of steps. So I'm just going to do this locally so we can step through it. First, we check out the code and get the repository. Typically, there's going to be enough semantic information here where I can derive things like the checkout commit that I'm using. I can do SHA-256 of the binaries I build. And we're just going to run it all locally here. And so I built this tool to help me. So it's called, I don't even know what it's called because I wrote it this morning. Go build. -H, there we go. And so what go build does, it takes a config, and what I decided to do, instead of like doing all the things that they specify, I wanted the developer to do as little as possible. If you pass in the sign flag, it'll use the default GPG key that's available and sign all the artifacts once they're done. And if you cut a release, then it will also create a release and upload it to GitHub inside of the repository so people can download all the artifacts and the signatures, and we'll talk about verification. So this is close to the last step here. So we're gonna run this command. Please be in my history. Oh, it's not all of it. But I bet I can figure it out. So we want to sign, and then we want a release. And I think the release version is like this, maybe. Demo gods. And we run this command. Okay, it seems to be doing something. So it's building that first binary. It's building the second binary, generating the SBOM, the source of providence, creating the exact signatures. Oh, I meant to take that line out. Creating a release on GitHub. Let's see if that worked. If it works, you're also supposed to clap really loud like I just changed the world. Let's see. Do I have a release? Ooh, I have a release. I have assets. So at this point, I think I've earned another badge. So we copy over the next README. Remember, the key is you have to celebrate all of these milestones. This stuff is hard. None of it is easy. So we grab the thing, and what do? Git add README, git commit -m, even more changes than before. The team was complaining my commit messages were too short. All right, and we push that up, and let's see where we're at. So we come here. We're at also level 3 now. And remember, we got to hold this behavior. We got to check the team. We got to make sure we're doing things the right way. Pragmatically, you step through this one by one. Now, one thing I didn't harp on again that I want to remind people of is that biggest part of the secure supply chain happens before we get to deployment. The industry spends a lot of time on patching servers and vulnerability scans, red, yellow, green. And I think all of that stuff should probably happen in the same pipeline. I'm not saying you don't need to do it anymore. But I'm saying is it's a different life cycle. A binary that's green today may be red tomorrow. So you're going to have to continuously run those things. And I know scanning software is super boring. And so one thing I did, and I want to remind you all, that security can be fun. And so instead of me running all of these commands, I decided to build myself some little tools to make me smile whenever I have to do security work. Now, the tool that I wrote, and it's really about never letting the little things get to you, right? Because these are little hacks. They take a lot of time. And so I have this attitude that this security stuff is a small price to pay to have more secure and reliable software. So I'm not going to let that get to me. And so the cool thing about Nelly, when it runs, I'm going to show you how it works. You basically give it some source, And the nice thing is there's so many great tools, and the thing is it's a wrapper behind this really cool tool called Gripe. You should check it out. You can have custom vulnerability databases. You can run stuff locally. And I think every developer probably owes it to themselves to get this vulnerability information before they push to their repository, so you don't have to wait until it gets scanned. And you saw what happened to my boss when I showed up like this. So we can prevent some of that by double checking things. So let's run Nelly now. We'll give it the source code, and we'll just say right here, and let's try it.
Hot air.
So now we found some vulnerabilities, and now I know what to fix. We're shifting left. We have the responsibility. We're starting to get the tools. We got the mind frame, mindset, and the framework. So the only thing left is to go out there and skill up on this stuff. Thank you. I think we're at time. There's time for questions, or should we call it? There's a couple mics, so if there's any questions, if not, that's cool too. All right, you got 5 seconds. All right. Oh, you're at a mic. Okay, I see you.
Is it on?
Yeah, it is on.
Hi, I was just wondering. So I noticed you were copying the readmes kind of manually to put the badges. Is there any way that you can kind of automatically detect maybe at least some of those metrics for whether you're at a certain level?
You know, I think there's going to be a lot around reputation. So the question is, I was just adding these badges, right? Like, what's stopping someone from going to their repository doing no work whatsoever and being like, badge? It's like, like, no, you're not compliant. I think what these badges communicate are that you're trying. And what we do, we have to hold each other responsible. And I think there's going to be reputation services at some point. So at some point, there will probably be some software registry where people are verifying these things, giving reputation. I don't think GitHub stars are enough to give people that reputation. But the goal is that if you're really doing this stuff, and these tools are yet to exist, so I think this is an opportunity for people to come out here and build. But what you really want to see when someone makes this claim is that I want to see all this stuff that we're seeing here in this release. I want to see that provenance. I want to see that it's signed. I want to see documentation that talks about how to verify. I want to see those SBOMs. And so when people document their process, then we should see the results. So the thing I think we should do is hold each other accountable that if people are going to wear the badge, like, dude, you're literally not in the Girl Scouts. Like, give me those badges back, right? You just can't say you are. But I think it's going to require a community, and it's going to be part of our engineering culture. So yes, do not use the badge unless you're doing the work. And I think that's what is going to communicate that you're at least trying to do these things. And maybe, just maybe, we should also have docs in our repository that talks about our security policy, our hygiene, and point to those automated builds. And I think that's why one of the first things that you see in some of those SOSA guidelines that you should have automated builds so people can see that's what you're actually doing and they can reproduce it for themselves. Great question.
Thank you very much.
Do you have any thoughts on sort of the repeatable build tools like Nix and how they tie into this stuff? And like, do you think it's on those sorts of tools to sort of shepherd ecosystems into this, or do you think it's on each individual ecosystem to really address this independently?
You know, I used to work in the Python community for a very long time. I used to contribute to tools like Disutils, PyPy, all of those tools. And the packaging situation at that time, and I don't know if it's still that way today, it was a nightmare. People had packages all over the place. Versions didn't mean what you thought they meant. And so as people collect all of these dependencies, you're just really crossing your fingers. The industry evolved. We have lock files, requirements.txt, all of these things. But the problem with most build systems, they have a fatal flaw. Even the ones that are pretty good, there's usually an element of time. Temporary paths typically get encoded in the artifacts. And so then the builds aren't reproducible. The Go team, again, I keep going back to the language that I use most often, they actually have a way for you to get reproducible builds. One thing that I actually do in my builds, and there's one element that I need to add to really make it reproducible, when I do my builds, I tend to trim the paths so that we're not having dynamic paths that change every build. So then the same input should reproduce the exact same output every time. There's another thing that I need to do here, which is remove the build ID and just use something like the version control information that you see here, build the VCS information in. So Golang by itself, it can do this because it knows how to build things and ignore some of the timestamp stuff, ignore some of the things that are dynamic, like dynamic temporary directories that are built in the build path. So I think Go has a head start here. They're doing a good job. When it comes to NixOS, right? So you mentioned Nix. And Nix has this fundamental principle all the way at the OS layer. And so some of the things that you saw happen in the container world, where you start to think about, can I create a layers or a collection of things and know what their versions are and then compose these file systems on demand? If I do that correctly, ideally, I should bit for bit be able to compose back the thing that I built before. I think it's a great general purpose situation because you're writing Ruby, you're writing Python, where things are all over the place. These type of systems can definitely help you get closer to that, but Nix is a big ass operating system, right? People are including way too many things in these Docker files. You know, I used to say this thing, you need to ship applications, not build environments. And so what happens is people put Nix in their Docker file from Nix, install the whole world. Yeah, it's reproducible, but this is a Go app. Why is Python 3.9 in there to begin with? So I think what we really have to ask ourselves is, what dependencies do we really need? So what I would like to see from more advanced build system is, they should be trimming things you aren't actually using. Some things can run things and observe the system calls. And then based on that, say, hey, this other stuff looks like junk. Would you like me to remove it? That's where we have to get as an industry, regardless of language, regardless of OS, but I definitely think the next people are onto something. Good question, thank you.
So do you have any advice or best practices when you're maintaining monorepos as far as building SBOMs or, you know, applications where there's multiple languages and multiple artifacts that get generated?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of the four-letter word, luck. Good luck. I do think systems like Bazel, you know, these things, like this thing is so complex. So if you see this, close your eyes. But if you have the problem you described, this tool has been hardened in production at Google and other places these days to try to deal with that issue. Like a common build process, regardless, developers can do way more granularity that in that sub-project, in that monorepo, you can specify your build commands, and it's really optimized for getting to those reproducible builds. And so it does a lot of things in weird ways that are not compatible with native build tools. So you do make a huge trade-off when you go this route, but there's a reason why something like this exists. So if you're dealing with monorepos where everything is kind of coupled together, you do need a build tool that's smart enough to know it needs to do things that are context-specific and have really granular build rules and strategies to do these builds. And plus, you don't want builds taking forever either, so it does great things like caching. So maybe you've seen it before, but Bazel is probably what you want to check out to deal with those monorepo scenarios in that way.
Thank you.
We go here, and then we'll go back there, and I think that'll wrap us.
So in the States, the government regulates like how we produce avionics software, and then in Europe, the government has GDPR, which real popular. I was wondering if you have thoughts on how Salsa is likely to interact with or head off government regulation.
Yeah, this is actually something I see. So I spend a lot of time in my executive duties at Google working with multinational companies, and this is becoming a real problem. I was working with a startup and they had an issue. Someone from a country that their customer did not want to have part of the code base, they got an open source contribution, and they had to make a decision. If they merge the commit, then they will be in violation of some government contracts. There's export regulations. US isn't the only place in the world. So all countries have their own views on this. A lot of the software stuff is becoming a sovereignty problem. And so depending on the relationship between various countries, and depending on where your commits are coming from, depending on what your citizenship is, you may not be allowed to contribute to some repositories. This is happening more and more, right? Software in the open source, we've gotten away with a lot of this stuff for a very long time. But remember, most of these projects run in all of these governments around the world, and they see this as a backdoor into their most critical system, so they want to know now who is doing this. I think the SALSA framework is starting to head that up. Number one, signed commits. Who is making this stuff? And you're right. At some point, I know the US government is starting to mandate the very bare minimum, like S-bombs. You're going to start to see mandates that you need to prove providence. I think you saw this with the solar winds. You know, I saw their executive testify in front of Congress. I think they're going to go with three bill systems and compare them across and start to look at everything that's going inside of those things. So I think as professional developers, the day will come where someone's going to say, who are you? Where is this software coming from? And you may be rejected based on your citizenship alone. That day is coming, but at least now we have a much better way of explaining what the rules are. Hey, this repository cannot accept contributions from these places. Not my decision, but that's the reality. So then people know what the rules are. I can just change my email address and pretend I'm from somewhere else and submit it anyway. But yes, this is a real thing, and it's coming faster than most people know.
So what are the top three things that you'd like to ask language designers to do to increase security with this?
You know what? A lot of our tools, first of all, y'all not competing. So when one project does something nice, it's okay to borrow ideas from other projects. There's nothing to win, actually. So that's step one. There's no language wars. There's only things to learn from each other. I think that's like number one takeaway I would like to see. And I think the Go team is really taking this stuff serious, because think about it. They know that now most people are getting software dependencies not from RPMs, not from Deb, not from apt-get, not from yum. They're getting them straight from upstream. So how do we deal with this problem now where developers need to communicate vulnerabilities, but they're not in a official package management ecosystem? There aren't maintainers that are looking for CVEs and reporting them. And then how do you file an issue upstream with the developer that doesn't necessarily have the skills to fill out CVEs? It's not an easy process. And so the Go team is trying to make things work in a very language-specific way that works with the build system. We can maintain a vulnerability database. We have a proxy that, even though people are pulling from source, you can bypass it if you choose. But you now have the option to have us maintain these CVEs. And when you click into it, you're seeing things in line with the documentation. It's just right there in the inner loop for the developer. So if I was a language designer, I would be asking myself, usually the compiler knows a lot more about what's going into the software than something that comes later and has to observe from the outside. And so putting that additional metadata, remember that command that I showed you, like that build info, I think that kind of stuff goes a long way in helping other tools. When you look at, let me see if I can find it. Here we go. When you look at the amount of semantic information that I'm getting from the binary alone, that means that runtime team is in tune with the needs of the security space. And so I would definitely ask yourself, how easy is it for people to get this information, produce these secure things? I mean, we even have a build flag that helps you get to a point where you can get reproducible builds without other tools. So I would probably say this, observe what's going on, look at the new demands, see how people are trying to solve it generically, and ask yourself, is there a way you can aid? One day, there should probably be a go generate SBOM command. There should be one for Rust. There should be one for Haskell, using all of these open standards. And that's the last thing I'll say. Please don't invent another standard. We don't need 10,000 of these things. We already have enough. But see if you can actually create data structures that can convert between them to make the lives of the other tool developers much easier. All right, I believe that's the last question. I appreciate you all for hanging out with me and hope you enjoy Strange Loop.